There we go.
All right.
Run into the screen. Hello. Welcome. Thanks for coming here today. As most of you know, I'm Michael DeJovine. I'm a professor of anthropology here at Westchester University. I'm the director of our Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology in the Museum Studies program. We have a lot of some museum studies students, some new ones, some older ones, some that curated the Beyond the Bell exhibition that opened up a couple weeks ago in the Museum of Anthropology and Archaeology. So if you haven't had a chance to see it, please do. Among other things in that exhibition are a number of contemporary artwork, paintings mostly, by leading artists in Philadelphia right now. And we're so lucky to have one, who have two pieces on display on exhibit at the exhibition right now. Before I introduce you, I did want to thank a couple of institutions, because that's always very important. So in addition to the Museum of Anthropology, I want to thank the Department of Art and Design, the Institute on Race and Ethnic Studies, and the Anthropology Club for sponsoring this public lecture by Anna Vizcarra Rankin. So Anna is an artist. In Philadelphia, she's Uruguayan American. She received her BA at Temple University in Philly, and then her MFA at Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts in Philly as well. She has a number of her paintings are in private collections as well as in public collections and museums as well. And you know, now we have two on temporary display here. Anna's work, the ones that we chose anyway to exhibit, are really focused on kind of what you see here, decolonizing our visual literacy, kind of looking at the structural inequalities that are embedded in power relations that are embedded particularly in maps and cartography. You could call it a little bit of cartographic aggression, or passive aggression. And how we can kind of move beyond that or look a little bit differently at the world and the way that we represent it, to become more global citizens. And global citizenship is something that's really important to me, important as an anthropologist, and I teach you guys this as well, to have a very open mind, understanding our role in the world and how our actions impact the world around us. Study abroad also is a very good way to do that as well. But at any rate, let me pass it over to you. You can talk more about that, and we're really happy to have you. So thank you. Welcome to Westchester University again. Yeah.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you so much for having me. And thank you, everyone, for being here and coming to share some of these ideas with me. My name is Anna Vizcarra Rankin. I go by AV, all the time, audiovisual, no pun intended. And I'm here to talk about maps, migration, and darkness. So let's get started. First, there was darkness. We think of life as beginning and ending with darkness. The opposite of light, it is a thing to be feared, and most creation myths universally feature a benevolent spirit as a bringer of light. Air, water, food, warmth, and safe company are universal needs. All civilizations began with odd respect towards the natural forces. Humans worshipped rivers, mountains, and sky. Then, as humanity evolved and magic gave way to religion and science, native cultures that had shaped their lives based on respect and love for the environment were colonized by missionaries and reshaped by scientists that were often more concerned with the afterlife or the acquisition of knowledge rather than the natural world around them. The proliferation of industry further led us away from experiencing life in the moment, of interacting directly with our planet, and placing our bodies within ecological ecosystems. Stargazing has always been a privilege. In the past, it was due to danger of wild beast attacks and a subsistence lifestyle for most people. That made it impossible to spend time awake and thinking during the hours of darkness. Most humans never really experienced what we think of today as education, about existential matters such as astronomy. Nowadays, the danger that we face going outside most often comes from other humans. And we still have very little time for realization. So we are, in a sense, back in a sort of subsistence lifestyle. And we've added to that light pollution. So this is this lecture, and before I go any further, I want to acknowledge that we are all here in occupied land. We are part of the Navajo Land, the Lenni Lenape. And the entirety of this lecture is going to be it's going to be from the point of view of my own artwork and visual language. But it is intended as a window into how each of us can foster a closer and kinder relationship with ourselves and with our surroundings. So in the next half hour or so, I'm going to barely scratch the surface of the implications that language and visualization have on our perception of reality and our ability to affect it. So continuing with this idea of stargazing, I'm going to talk about our eyeballs for a moment. Healthy eyes take about a half hour to gain significant light sensitivity. This is a long time in today's fast-paced society. So naked eye stargazing requires you to relax, which is itself a dying art. Dilated pupils are associated with arousal and increased neural activity. Unlike the UV damage that we experience from excessive sunlight, spending time in the dark can be beneficial for your eyes, especially if you are not straining to see something up close in the dark, such as reading a book or crafting with a needle. Also, when you hobble, the sense that we most rely on, it also has the effect of bringing our other, often forgotten senses to our attention. Darkness has also been documented to have significant benefits to our circadian rhythms and those of the creatures and plants that surround us. So this is a handy little chart from the magazine Optometry, Science, Techniques, and Clinical Management. And it shows you how it takes about 10 minutes to really, right there, to really start to see the stars. And that's, you know, where the cones inside our eyeballs are detecting all the detail around us. But then in the following 30 or 40 minutes, the rods inside our eye start to take hold, and we really start to perceive things that we are not used to seeing, since they are the part of our eye that detects shapes. So the anatomy is really interesting. So let's begin with these two. On the left is a star chart that was mapped by, right here, Vincenzo Maria Coronelli. He published this map in 1695. And on the right is one of my own star maps, which I created from information which I gathered through naked eye stargazing in 2015. It's hard to see in this image, but Hercules is in the center right here, and Hercules is in the center right here. In my picture, he is wearing donkey ears. The name of this painting is Old Midsummer, and I sort of recast Hercules as Bottom from Midsummer's Night Dream by William Shakespeare. And this was sort of the beginning of my foray into the idea of renaming and recontextualizing the stories that we see when looking at the sky. because not only the places in our planet, but our very stars have been christened, and I use that word very specifically, by males who were driven by the idea of superiority. A lot of the stories that are happening in the sky that have been standardized are concerned with triumph in war, ruling of kingdoms, and the subjugation of women, children, beasts, and the nature around us. With this painting, I began to imagine what it would be like to have a sky where instead of the most visible constellation, which in our case is usually Orion. Raise your hand if you know Orion. Yeah, everybody knows Orion. If instead of a great warrior, if Orion were a great mother with flowing skirts and a belt full of life-giving treasures, geoglyphs suggest that this was the case in some ancient cultures, and we have now sort of standardized the way that we look at constellations according to the Greco-Roman mythology. My work deals with data and scale, specifically human scale, and what that means in relation to science, time, technology, and standardization. When I created Old Midsummer, the previous meaning, I had no idea that I would find a star chart in the Princeton Rare Maps collection that contained an almost exact depiction of the same constellation, all the same constellations from 500 years earlier. So that was a really humbling and eye-opening or pupil-dilating moment for me. And in this image, I am in the Atlantic Ocean, soaking one of my cotton canvases in salt water to kind of tighten the fabrics and make them softer. I call it brining. I do sometimes use stargazing apps because they're super useful. But we should always remember that phone apps, or apps in general, are intended to keep you looking at your phone. So you must be sure to at least use one with the infrared option so that your eyes aren't contracting to deal with the light. And more importantly, to take it outside, because you're not really stargazing when you're sitting on your couch inside your living room and pointing your phone at your ceiling. Although I suppose it's better than playing Call of Duty or shoot the zombies or whatever. This image is here to help us get an idea of the difference in scale between the sort of astrographs that we are used to seeing coming from Hubble telescope and other digital telescopes, and then these star maps, star charts, are the entire dome of the sky. So you can see, you know, these two stars right here are these two stars right here. And this image would fit right there, basically in the inside the laser pointer. And also these colored images show a massive amount of space. This Rosetta Nebula is a couple of light years in size, and light years are a measure of distance instead of time. These two images and the Hubble and James Webb images, and also there's a lot now of private amateur astronomers that are capturing amazing images. They make up a lot of the reference material for my astronomy paintings. And I think it's important to point out that they're not photographs. This is now becoming a little better understood by the general public with the launch of the James Webb Telescope, which is named after a white male government official. The colors that are shown here come from data that's collected outside of the visible spectrum. So the white in these images are visible light, but the reds and the blues are usually used to describe oxygen emissions or hydrogen emissions. Sometimes the red is used to show infrared, which is how the Chandra telescope captures data, or microwaves, or radio waves. So we can't see any of those things. And to create these images, which are actually maps, we translate them into color. We are finally beginning to diversify some of our naming conventions. Caltech's Palomar Observatory, which is located in a heavily forested mountain near San Diego, recently named an asteroid orbiting close to Venus in the Luiseno language of the Paloma people, who are native to the region and had a close relationship with their neighboring planet due to their harvesting schedule for black oak acorns, which they would ritually climb the mountain to get this rare and nutritious food. I do want to point out that naming space things after earthly things is going to continue to be the norm, because it is all that we can know. In the vastness of our known universe, our planet is the only one known to harbor life. So as we're all aware by now, we humans are doing an excellent job of exterminating large swaths of living things that are either not human or not currently useful to humanity. So, as an advocate for dark skies and space exploration, I believe astrocartography is a very important feature of how we approach our universe and how we will think of our infinitesimal time and place in history. This Bubble Nebula, which is an oil painting that's about 10 inches by 10 inches and currently resides in a private collection in Chicago, feels like a lovely metaphor for a lot of things for me. For example, I never really appreciated bubbles until I saw the delight and wonder that my child experiences anytime she sees one. It feels very important to change our course when, at the rate we're going, the Elephant Nebula, which is this painting, has become easier to observe on a screen than live elephants roaming free. But let's return to Earth. This drawing is called Nuestro Norte es el Sur. It means our north is the south. It was drawn by Joaquin Torres Garcia in 1943, he was a very influential and prolific Uruguayan constructivist artist and philosopher who traveled extensively through his life and befriended people such as Mondrian and Gaudi. This drawing is present everywhere in Uruguay where I grew up. So I really internalized it as a child without realizing how important it would be to me later in my life. Here I am at the MoMA in New York City in 2015 during the Joaquin Torres Garcia solo exhibition. And you can see his drawing had been used for the vinyl. And this drawing was an 8.5 by 11 white sheet of paper, and it was printed paper. But it has become so emblematic, and that even though they had the original, they needed to blow it up, put it right up front. And that same year, well, I guess the year before, I created this painting, which is about 8 feet by 10 feet, honoring Nuestro Norte es el Sur for an exhibition that I did at the Uruguayan Embassy in Washington, D.C., and then it was shown at the 2014 Woodmere juried exhibition. Right, so some of my earliest memories are from my grandfather's so-called bookstore, which was essentially a covert way to continue disseminating culture after he was removed from his teaching position, which he later recovered with the return of democracy. After moving from Uruguay to Oklahoma as a tween, I became interested in the correspondences between the stories I knew from the Bible, classical literature, Hindu beliefs, Chinese fables, and the tales that I heard from my Native American friends in the nearby Cherokee Reservation. During graduate school in Pennsylvania, I shared my research with teaching faculty, and they encouraged me to find my own story. As a mixed-race immigrant with conflicting cultural influences, their suggestion proved to be more challenging than they probably intended. It really made me question what I thought about my ancestors and the people who shaped me, which led me to my current avenue of study into mapping and data visualization. There is nothing inevitable or intrinsically correct about the North being at the top, because up on a map is a human construction, not a natural one. There is no up in outer space, for example. Some of the very earliest Egyptian maps show the south as up, presumably because the Nile flows northward and was associated with the force of gravity. There was a long stretch in the medieval era when most European maps were drawn with the east on top, because that's where the sun comes from. In the same period, Arab and Chinese map makers often drew maps with the south facing up. This famous map, known as the Tabula Rogeriana, shows Africa as a giant landmass hovering over the Mediterranean. Anybody can pronounce the name of this map. I would love to hear it. The Nuzat al-Mushtaq Fiktirak Alafa by Muhammad al-Idrisi. Very, very famous, and you can see Africa right here. And the Mediterranean. It's remarkable to think that this map could exist when we had no way to have an overhead view. This was all done just with ships skirting the shoreline. In the 14th and 15th centuries, sailors began using oceanographic maps of increasing complexity with the help of a recently adopted technology, namely the compass. Even though the arrow of the compass is simply a magnetized metal needle that aligns with the Earth's magnetic field, European mariners were used to navigating according to the North Star. So the earliest compass roses differentiated the North with a hat or a similar embellishment, even though the maps had no up or down. Pictures and words faced inward. Many mariners saw the compass as an artificial replacement for the star on cloudy nights, and even assumed that it was the pull of the star itself that drew the needle north. The map on the right here is one of my more recent maps, which is also headed to Chicago to another private collection. I'm delivering it next week, I'm very excited. Was based on the Spillhouse projection. The title of the map is The World According to Fishes. Athelstan Spillhouse was a South African-American geophysicist and oceanographer who was a devoted lover of all things oceanic and prescient in his urgency for maritime wildlife conservation. He divided this map along the major land masses. And thus he enabled us to see the oceans as a whole, This is incredibly disorienting for most people because we generally think of the water as peripheral and marginal. So you can see Antarctica here in the center and the Arctic right here at the bottom. So this right here in gold is the equator. These folks that presented this reference material created a digitized version that fits perfectly in the square. And I didn't find it until I was done with this map. So I feel like I need to redo it because it's so beautifully symmetrical, the way that these computer scientists put it together, that I'm definitely going to revisit this projection. This map is also concerned with the ocean. It's from 2015. It's called More Massive Map. It is based on data collected by NOAA, which is short for the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. You can see here the warmth plume that was caused by the Fukushima meltdown. You can see it right here. And how it was affecting the western coast of South America. So when Fukushima melted down, the Galapagos Island got irradiated. You can also see the blue from where glaciers are melting in Antarctica and the Arctic. And all these white areas right here, it's hard to see in the image, are areas where we were missing data in 2015. So now, almost a decade later, we have found that the data that we are now able to get with the better technology that we've developed in the last few years is a lot more dire than we realized in 2015. These colors and the rainbow as a signifier are the same sort of visualization tool that was being used in the astronomy images. It's also false color. This was the very first world map that I ever painted, the very first big one. It is now in Paphos Museum collection. And I used these drips to emphasize the direction that it needed to be hung in. It hung in that exhibition in the graduate student show that they do every year for six weeks. And people would look at it and say, wow, what a wonderful painting. It's a map, isn't it? And I said, yes. And then they'd say, what is it a map of? It was so disorienting that people wouldn't even recognize it as a world map. This map I lifted directly from a wonderful website called the Decolonial Atlas. So this is not one of my works. It was designed by Jordan Engel. It shows cultural and biodiversity, and it points out how language extinction correlates with species extinction. I'm missing one other map that goes with this one. Inhuman activity has increased the species extinction rate to 10,000 times the historically normal rate. And of the planet's 7,000 languages, most are predicted to go silent in the next century. Native people are responsible for the conservation over a disproportionately high percentage of the few natural environments left. Biocultural diversity is a global manifestation of life on Earth that arises from local interactions between people and nature. Most of us are descendants of colonizers, or as I like to sarcastically refer to them, the winners. But we're all part of our individual culture and our ecosystem, starting with our backyards, which can be either a sterile monoculture of mowed grass, or a fertile garden full of life and color, or something in between. All the way to our entire planet as an enclosed, zero-sum environment. In 2000, TerraLingua produced the first map of the global overlaps between biological and linguistic diversity. The results of this work have supported the development of international policy as well as advocacy for indigenous peoples' rights. This map here shows the name for Earth in 250 languages, which are just a fraction of the languages that are used throughout the world. This is not to say that we should rely entirely on or continue to fetishize native people as noble savages or nature as beautiful and nurturing. We must remain humble as we continue to realize that our metrics keep evolving as the situation changes. For example, this map, which is currently being shown here at the museum, shows how traditional IQ tests are not indicative of intelligence, but actually of how we have decided to measure what we think of as intelligence. A carrot knows a lot more about soil composition than any human, but is currently incapable of sharing that knowledge with us. This is one of the maps also on display in the Beyond the Bell exhibition. It shows wind currents and, well, this is actually a sketch for a larger map that shows how wind currents are carrying different makeup of particulates due to desertification, an increase in wildfires, and more severe hurricanes. And this one's pretty early. I have a couple more of these in the works that show from the following years up to 5 hurricanes happening at the same time. So this is almost a baseline of when we didn't have that many wildfires going on, and we had some typical hurricanes happening. But we were already dealing with more desertification coming from the Pampas as well. The new data that I've gathered is it's wild. You can see all the fires that are happening in the Northwest Coast, Australia on fire, and 5 hurricanes going at the same time. They're not putting out those fires. So we're getting some pretty clear data on the changing climate and how we're affecting it. A lot of it makes us feel helpless, but I think that our ability to have already made such impactful changes, even though we're such a small part of this big planet, which is itself a small part in an enormous universe, should actually be giving us hope that we can do the same in the opposite direction and return as much of our environment and ourselves as we can to a wilderness that has been reframed by our acknowledgement of the potential devastation that we are capable of. So this brings me to my newest large world map, which is currently on view at the Schuylkill Center for Environmental Conservation. It's called Forest Futures Growth. And it references the way that economists talk about the improvement of investment assets. It is a call to remind us that in the world, in the words of Wangari Maathai, a woman who is known for having planted 1 million trees, a tree is worth more than its wood. Even though deforestation has existed since the earliest human civilizations, forest loss has exploded since the advent of industrialization, leaving only a shrinking third of the earth covered with arboreal habitats. At the same time, our connection to and understanding of trees and forests has also diminished. Movements such as the Trillion Tree Campaign, which is what this study was based on that informed this map, aimed to make worldwide reforestation and afforestation a socioeconomic imperative that not only restores landscapes adapting to climatic change, but also attaches monetary and legal value to trees. This map visualizes the global potential tree cover that will be required to counterbalance our current carbon footprint. What might the world look like if forest ecosystems are not only respected for the sake of human survival, but also for nature in its own right? I consider myself to be part of an artistic dialogue concerning the role that mapping plays in our idea of place, both within the landscape and our societies. The control and presentation of information is an important part of cartography. Renaming locations and reintroducing almost forgotten words is also an invitation to let our imagination create an alternative potential reality. Environmental colonialism, along with all its disastrous consequences, is enforced by accelerated capitalism and has implications for any discussion of decolonialization, particularly when the focus broadens to land, heritage, and appropriation, which are all parts of political jurisdiction. This act of renaming can assist with a shift towards the advancement of ideas such as naturehood and the granting of rights to non-human entities, including species and ecologies in need of conservation. Oh, here I am with one of my maps as a reminder of what I mean by human scale. And this is a repeat. I could not finish this talk without bringing up my Flesh Planets project, which are a hyper object made up of hundreds of similar collages that are made up themselves of upcycled paper, which is generally made from virgin tree pulp. A hyper object, and I neglected to write down the gentleman that coined that term, is an object that is distributed across space and time in such a way that it transcends localization. So these collages are made from hundreds of magazines that either I have collected or have been given to me by people that know about this project. They're from all over the world. Some folks got very enthusiastic with hustlers and playboys that are all vintage, some amazing photography from the 60s and 70s and 80s. Essentially, they started as a materials experiment when I was coordinator in the Works of Paper Conservation Lab. But they have inspired a surprising amount of writing from art history academics and curators, including a paper being presented by the soon-to-be Dr. Nicole Mercer in this year's College Art Association conference. I believe that the Flesh Planets ask a lot more questions than they answer. Now, if you can imagine, just I've made a few hundred of these, and they all look the same. They all present as like a sphere of human flesh, kind of surrounded by a carefully curated, pristine environment. One of my favorite questions that they ask is, will our world soon be made of nothing that is not human or of use to humans? Can we be a part of our environment without destroying it? Must we look without touching? Or can we kind of massage our surroundings back into a shape reminiscent of the old lost Garden of Eden? Each of us sees a different world and brings our own beauty to it. So your point of view is just as valid as mine, or that of any of our greatest, most powerful world leaders. We may be microbes floating on the dust mote that is the pale blue dot of our planet, but we have progressed this far, and it is up to us to progress further into a kinder and more equitable wilderness, both for humans and for all other beings. So thank you very much for coming, and I will now accept any questions that you might have for me. Yes?
Well, first I'll start with a comment. I think what I really appreciate about your work is that you're not only redefining what has been taken away from so many cultures, which is like the land, the maps, and like the identity and all that kind of stuff, but you're finding ways to turn, identities from colonialism, like Playboy magazines and things like that, into its own new identity. Have you heard of the Lena image? Do you know what that is?
The Lena?
Yeah, Lena image.
No.
It's an image that's used in computer science in order to test like image algorithms, and it's stripped away from like a Playboy magazine, and it's just a lot of history to it. And
L-I-N-E?
Yes. Okay. Or L-E-N-E, something like that.
Okay.
So what inspires you to kind of redefine images that are of like, you know, complicated pasts? Like what motivates you to do those kind of things?
Sure. So the art market today and the art world is very self-conscious about its past. And, you know, you have movements like the Gorilla Girls that are pointing out that most of the artwork in museums, nude women painted by men, generally white men. So they're making a really concerted effort to start collecting work by women, work by people of color. But the thing is, most of this work is about the experience of being a woman or being a person of color. And there's this sort of encouragement to point out, as a non-white, non-male person, how important that part of your identity is. And this is something that I really kind of butted up against in grad school, because I don't want to talk to you about how I don't have a penis and I can tan in the summer. You know, I want to be able to paint like a guy. I want to paint about things that interest me. And what interests me is data and science. And I was making these kind of abstract paintings that were very sort of expressionist, right? But I felt like they lacked a spirit. And so I kind of brought back this idea of comparative mythology that I had been working with before, which as an art history and critical thinking student, you know, they got all chopped up, and sort of turned them into something that I feel has relevant content without using this narrative of, you should look at my artwork because it's giving you insight into the non-male, non-white condition. It's more of a, you know, and I even use AAV when applying to grants, and have found that the response is different when I use my full name that shows that I am a woman of Latin descent versus if I just use my initials and my last name. There's positives and negatives to both, but definitely the feedback that I get back is different, and it would probably be its own piece of artwork, just documenting how people react differently to non-gender application as they do to ethnic gender application. I don't know if that answered your question, but.
No, it did, because it's like, what motivates you? It's not only just for expression, it's to make a statement.
And I like the art that I'm making.
It's beautiful.
I mean, thank you. I enjoy it, and I think it's relevant, and I can just keep making it till I die, which is not something that I felt Anybody else? Thanks again for coming.
Thank you. Well, thanks so much.